If you're looking for a high horsepower convertible, but your budget doesn't run into the six figures, then look no further than the Camaro ZL1 convertible. At the moment, this really stands alone because there is no high horsepower version of the Ford Mustang convertible for some reason, and Dodge has never chopped the top off the Challenger. In an interesting sort of way, you could see the Camaro as sort of a competitor to something like the BMW M4 convertible because it will give you performance that is almost as good as this Camaro, and the bones of the Camaro date back to the Cadillac ATS, which was designed as a very direct competitor to the BMW lineup, but the Camaro itself is just a very different vehicle than the BMW. Up front, we get the angriest interpretation of the Camaro front end, although this has never been quite as controversial as the front end that we saw on the 2019 Camaro SS. Now, for 2020, Chevy has fixed the Camaro SS front end, and they really haven't done anything to the ZL1 because this looks aggressive, but it doesn't look quite as unusual, shall we say, as the Camaro SS. We have HID headlamps up front, not LEDs like we do find in some of the other alternatives out there, and absolutely massive air intakes all the way around. Those are in order to cool the 6.2-liter supercharged V8 engine under the hood. Chevy tells us that just about every square inch of cooling availability was used in this vehicle to feed the nearly a dozen heat exchangers that are under the hood. If you're wondering why I'm not filming this video at our usual setting, this very low front bumper is the prime reason. I was concerned that I wouldn't be able to make it to where we film just about every other car that we film. This is a very, very low front splitter, and you will definitely hit this on parking lot headstones like the one that's right behind me if you're not careful. Unfortunately, there's no front camera in the ZL1. I think that's a serious omission in a lot of performance cars out there. Most of the high performance vehicles that we test here at Alex and Autos don't have a front camera, and that would be very, very handy so that you'd know exactly what you're gonna hit. When you look at the Camaro from the side, it's obvious that this vehicle was designed from the very beginning to also have a convertible variant. All the lines definitely work from the side. And that's not something we can say for all of the various convertibles out there, including some of the conversions that we've seen for the Dodge Challenger. Now, at 190.2 inches long, the ZL1 is a little bit longer than the normal convertible, mainly in order to handle all the extra cooling that has to go on right up front. This is just about the same size as the Ford Mustang in terms of overall length, but definitely considerably shorter than the Dodge Challenger. Remember that the Challenger is based on the Chrysler 300, which is a pretty big sedan, and there wasn't too much they could do to try and shrink it down, whereas this was based on the Cadillac ATS, a compact luxury car. Perhaps the most important thing to know about the Camaro ZL1 convertible is that versus the ZL1 Coupe, this is definitely more of a GT-style vehicle, so the ride is notably softer. In addition to whacking the top off, there were a few other changes to convert the ZL1 Coupe into the ZL1 convertible. This has a slightly softer suspension tune, so this really is more of a GT style ride than we find in the Camaro ZL1 Coupe. They've also given us different roll bars up front and in the back. These have more play to them, allowing a bit more body roll than we see in the Coupe. It's also worth noting that there is no 1LE package available for the convertible at the moment. That means that instead of the absolutely insane 305 width tires that we find available in the Coupe, up front we have to make do with just slightly insane 285 width tires up front, 305s in the back versus the 325s that we find in the 1LE Coupe. Out back we have combination tail lamps, so we get some LED elements and some incandescent elements. You can see the turn signal blinking right back there on the other side. We also get the standard spoiler right here. Now this is just a trunk lid where the spoiler is attached. The lid for the roof is right over here behind it. Like the Camaro SS, we have a 6.2 liter V8 engine under the hood, but unlike the SS, this is a supercharged 6.2 liter V8, so power goes up from 455 horsepower to 650, and torque goes from 455 up to 650 as well. Like most of the Camaro lineup, this is available with either a 6-speed manual transmission or the 10-speed automatic transmission that we're driving this week, and either engine will get you 16 miles per gallon combined. Some folks have been asking why you might want the 10-speed automatic transmission instead of the previous generation 8-speed. Well, this 10-speed is going to get you faster 0 to 60 for most folks than the 6-speed manual, and it's also going to be much more engaging than the previous generation 8-speed. It shifts an awful lot faster. Front seat comfort is pretty comparable to the Mustang convertible, although I do find it a little interesting that even at this purchase price, we don't have an adjustable lumbar support in the Camaro. I think that's a little bit of a mistake. I really would have liked to have seen at least some adjustability. This is a relatively comfortable car for a long highway journey. So if you're going to go out wine tasting on a weekend and you're going to drive 200 to 300 miles a day in something like this Camaro, then lumbar support is gonna be pretty important for some folks out there, and I wish it was included in this vehicle. But other than that, the seating position is relatively comfortable. If I can find the steering wheel adjuster there, you can see that we have a moderate amount of motion, not an extreme amount of motion for that steering column, but it should make it easier for shorter or taller drivers to find a decent driving position. Now, it's worth noting that the sills in this vehicle are very high. That's something that a lot of folks out there have complained about with the Camaro, and it is something that I noticed during a week with this vehicle. Even at 6 feet tall, sitting comfortably here in the driver's seat, I found it a little bit awkward to put my elbow up there on the windowsill. I think that's a little bit of a shame because that's a very classic driving position, of course, for a convertible. Aside from that, headroom is pretty decent. We have about 2 inches of headroom left. The seat is not quite on the floor for me. And we do have a reasonable amount of legroom in the Camaro as well. We have a little bit more headroom and a little bit more legroom than we find in the Mustang. Now, because of the very compact dimensions of the Camaro, I'm not even gonna bother sitting in the seat behind me, because with this front seat adjusted for me at 6 feet tall, the front seat is almost touching the back seat. There really is no legroom left. And even though we find a little bit more room back there than in something like the Mustang, it's not really enough for an adult. If you wanted to put an adult in the back of your American performance car, then you are gonna have to get something like the Dodge Challenger. It has a functional back seat and it has 3 seat belts back there rather than the 4 that we see in this or in the Ford. I've stopped the fabric roof's operation so you can see exactly what's going on here. This section covers just the top when it is folded down, and then it forms part of the back end of the vehicle when the top is upright, like it's going to be in a moment here. But you can see that this occupies a great deal of space that would normally be reserved for cargo. The result of that is that we have a pretty tiny trunk. If you want to put the top down, there's enough room back here for one 22-inch roller bag. That's the biggest size you can carry onto a domestic flight in America. If you were to leave the top up like it is now, then you could put about 2 22-inch roller bags, slide them in under there in the area that's normally occupied by the top when it's down, but obviously you'd have to leave the top up, and then you could put a small amount of carry-on luggage behind it. However, in our 24-inch roller bag test, none of the 24-inch roller bags we had were able to squeeze right there into the trunk, and that's why the score is 0. Going in for a closer look, you can see what's going on. We have this somewhat flimsy divider right here that has to be latched into place right like that for you to be able to operate the top. And this is all the room you've got. Now, you can detach that, lay it down, and then you can see you could put some of those longer items right in there. You get definitely a lot more room available. However, you can't do that and operate the top. But any way you slice it, we get less cargo room back here than in the coupe. Taking a quick spin around the interior, right up here by the rearview mirror, we find the button that controls the top operation. It can also be controlled via the remote. We then have the buttons for the OnStar system, and then the rearview mirror. It also has a backup camera mode if you get that particular option. Moving over to the passenger side, you can see that we have the Recaro seats here. We have two-way adjustable headrests, and then we have a pretty big pillar right back there that's formed by the convertible top. I've decided to film this initially with the top up so that way you can see what this looks like. Overall, rearward visibility is pretty similar to the Camaro Coupe, and as you can see, the rear seats don't have any headrests back there. That's probably fine because they don't really have much headroom either. As you can see, putting the top down completely solves any visibility problems. We have a complete unobstructed view of the rear end. Going in for a closer look, you can see that we have perforated sections for the headrest and the center of the seat back and seat bottom cushion. We have the ZL1 logo right there in the middle of that seat back and Recaro right above it. The bolstering on the seat back and seat bottom cushion is pretty aggressive, but I found these seats quite comfortable, again with the exception of the lack of lumbar support. One thing worth noting is that even though these seats are ventilated, we don't get quite as much air through these perforations in this sort of Alcantara-like fabric as we would in a leather seat. So do keep that in mind if you're driving this in a hotter climate. Moving over to the front doors, we find a combination of materials here. So we find more of that suede-like material right at the top, right there in that door insert and the armrest and that little trim panel right there, but the rest of the door is made from harder plastics. The trim on the doors is a brushed metal trim, and it is real metal. In the middle of that, we have an accent light strip. The color is adjustable via the software. You can see it loops right there around the door handle. Just in front of that, we have the Bose speakers right down there at the bottom. Moving over to the dashboard, we find more of that faux suede trim with red stitching right there. The upper section of the dashboard is a hard plastic. I was a little bit disappointed in that. I had expected more of a soft touch feel right there. On the passenger side, we have a bin-style glove compartment. I was barely able to fit a medium-sized tablet computer in there. Some of the larger ones probably won't fit. And then right here in the middle of everything, we have a color touchscreen infotainment system. There's another accent light strip that runs right there across the top, and then there's some physical buttons at the bottom. From this angle, you can really tell that the screen is definitely canted towards the driver and the front passenger. That's in order to reduce glare, especially when the top is down, but it does cause the screen to look a little bit unusual from some angles on the inside of the cabin. A nice touch, however, is that the bezels are all the way out here for the touchscreen, so we don't have a separate bezel right here where you see the image begin. We do have Apple CarPlay and Android Auto integration in the system, and this is running General Motors' latest infotainment software. You can see the button right there for Android Auto. We also have some integrated apps here in the system, the ability to download more apps through that My App function right there, Wi-Fi hotspot, OnStar services right there. This is how we would adjust the ambient lighting. You have all these various different colors to choose from, or you can link it to the drive mode. Under the infotainment system, we have a row of buttons. This is where we find the buttons for the ventilated seats, heated seats, the temperature for each of the two climate control zones. You adjust the temperatures with these rings around the air vents up front, and this knob opens and closes the vent right there. You can then adjust it in a variety of different directions. This is also where we find the fan controls, the button to sync those systems together, and the hazard light button for the car. But if I zoom out from there, you'll notice one thing. There's not a lot of storage going on up here, so I found myself during the week that we had this always putting my cell phone right here, which was a little bit annoying, especially if you get the model with the manual transmission. The shifter is a pretty traditional console design. We pull back towards the driver for drive, pull to the left for the manual mode, we push away for gear up, and we pull towards the driver for gear down. Moving back in the center console, we have a button to turn off the stability control right there. We have a drive mode selector. This allows us to choose between track, sport, snow, ice, and touring. We then have the electric parking brake, a 12-volt power outlet right there, two decently sized cup holders with a little bit more accent lighting right there in the middle. And then we have a fairly small storage area right there under that center armrest. This is where we find the USB input and auxiliary input for the system. You'd have difficulties putting some of the larger smartphones in that cubby. The instrument cluster is a partial LCD unit. It's very similar to some of the LCD designs we've seen out of GM in their trucks and the rest of their car lineup. We have a number of different performance readouts on this screen in addition to those extra gauges up top. Just as you'd expect in a modern performance vehicle, those include Gs, front, back, side to side, etc., 0 to 60 timers, lap timers, bigger gauges for the oil temperature, oil pressure, battery voltage, etc. And if you're really intent on tracking this car, an important handy feature here is going to be the tire temperature gauge right there. The steering wheel design is similar to the rest of the Camaro lineup. It has a flat bottom right there, pretty aggressive sport grips up top, but overall it's definitely thinner rimmed than what we see in the Challenger. We have shift paddles on the back, down on the left, and up over there on the right. That moves the track forward backward buttons to down here at the bottom of the steering wheel, and the volume up down over there on the other side. On this side we find the buttons that control that multifunction LCD along with a phone and voice command button, and then on the left side we have the heated steering wheel button and the cruise control controls. We don't find any adaptive cruise control in this model, however. It's just standard cruise control. While looking at the steering wheel, I have to say that I'm a little bit torn about this faux suede covering on the steering wheel. I've seen a lot of steering wheels out there with this coating that have been out in the wild for about 5 or 6 years, and they start looking just a little bit dirty, a little bit mangy to me. I really wish this had a leather steering wheel instead. I know that a lot of folks like this look, and it really does look and feel great when the vehicle is new, but you can see that this is already starting to get some shiny spots, and this particular model only has about 6,000 miles on it, so definitely keep that in mind when you're taking a look at different wheel options. On the driver's side door, we find the window switches, but you'll notice something a little unusual. We have these two little buttons right up here. That's because even though the Camaro convertible has four windows, the two main windows and then the two little windows behind the ones on the door, we only have two window switch controls, which is a little bit odd. So if you want to raise those rear windows, we have to click this button first, then pull these two up, and then it will raise or lower the rear windows. If you want to control the windows on the doors, we have to press that button right there, then we can raise or lower them right like that. That's a little bit confusing. It also takes a little bit more time if you just want to close all the windows or open all the windows at one go. If you've watched this channel for any length of time, then you know that I'm not the biggest fan of absolutely hardcore sports cars. I find them just a little bit too compromised for daily driving, and theoretically, this Camaro is definitely designed for someone that's going to drive it on their daily commute and, of course, have an awful lot of fun out on the weekends. So I was a little bit concerned when I first scheduled the ZL1 convertible out here for a weekly review, but I was pleasantly surprised because this definitely feels different than the top-end, most hardcore version of the Coupe. We have a notably softer ride in the convertible, And as I noted earlier, the 1LE package is not available on the convertible at the moment. But in addition to the lack of that particular package, we also have a softer suspension and roll bars that aren't quite as large in diameter. That means that we get a little bit more body roll, a little bit more of a GT feel out on the road. And that's something that I definitely prefer. If I were shopping for a ZL1 convertible, this is exactly the model that I would get. Now, as some of you were asking over at facebook.com/alexandautos, yes, cutting the roof off of this does affect the rigidity. And depending on the road surface that you're on, you can feel a little bit of chassis flex. But this does not feel like a wet noodle. This does not feel like a 1990s Chrysler Sebring. But you will notice the flex if you're going over an uneven driveway, for instance, with the lid up, then you will get a little bit of squeak, just the barest hint of flex. But that's pretty normal in the convertible segment. If you wanted that absolutely rigid, hardcore track vehicle, then you definitely want the Coupe. But if you want one of the fastest convertibles available in America, especially one that is under $100,000, then this is definitely going to be one of the best options. This is incredibly quick. In our 0 to 60 test, this went 0 to 60 in 3.7 seconds. This is a little bit slower than the Coupe. There are a few reasons for that. In addition to the extra curb weight, remember that we don't have the availability of the ZL1 package in the Camaro convertible, and we don't have the same rear axle that we find in the Coupe version. That seems to allow a little bit more wheel slip, so the stability control system has to intervene a little bit more. Now, it's worth noting that our 0 to 60 times here at Alex and Autos are never when using launch control. If you did use the launch control system in this vehicle, I suspect it would be a little bit quicker. There are a ton of different launch control options to choose from in this instrument cluster. You can adjust the amount of wheel slip that you want, the engine RPM, etc. All that's configurable in there, but most people aren't going to be using that because it does require that you're in the track mode, and you also have to go into the more limited stability control mode. And personally, with this much horsepower on tap, I would like all the nannies to be on. And that's not really a problem for the ZL1 convertible because this is absolutely wicked fast, regardless of the mode that you're in. When talking about ZL1 performance, remember that the fastest 0 to 60 times in this vehicle are going to be with the 10-speed automatic transmission. That's because this transmission can quite simply shift faster than you can. The 10-speed also has some very advantageous gear ratios. A lot of folks over at facebook.com/alexnautos were asking how I feel about this transmission versus the previous GM 8-speed. This transmission is probably the best implementation of this 10-speed that I've ever driven. Whether we're talking about this transmission under the hood of GM's pickup trucks, there are other vehicles out there, or the Ford Mustang. Because remember that this transmission is very, very similar to the 10-speed that we see in the Mustang, but the software is completely different. This software was entirely up to General Motors. And this has some very quick shifting characteristics. That's the big difference between this and the 8-speed automatic, is that the shifts in this transmission are much, much faster. And that really allows you to have that 0 to 60 performance and also the passing performance that we find in the ZL1. This is almost a psychic transmission here. So if you're just going around the corner here and you're in sixth or fifth gear and you romp on the throttle, this will almost instantly downshift. And that downshift is incredibly smooth. I think that this has a greater level of polish than the last ZF6 or 8-speed automatic transmissions that we've tested. This is an almost perfect 10-speed automatic transmission, and I hope that this software tune makes its way into the rest of the GM product line. The 10-speed automatic transmission is going to be a big difference between this and something like that Mustang GT500, because even the best dual clutch transmissions out there on the market have an awful lot of problems when it comes to slow and go or stop and go traffic. They're going to be definitely herky-jerky compared to a traditional automatic like this. And interestingly enough, in real-world driving, you're probably also going to be getting the best fuel economy with the automatic transmission versus the 6-speed manual. In our 60-0 stopping tests, this posted one of the shortest stopping distances ever recorded here at Alex and Autos, 97 feet in this model. And remember, this one is not the 1LE model with the even wider tires, although the tires of this model are already pretty insane. And this is not terribly heavy when you compare this against other high-performance entries in this segment, most notably like the Dodge Challenger Hellcat. That is an awful lot heavier than the Camaro. And that's why when it comes to handling, this definitely gets an A overall. Now, I do think that this doesn't handle quite as well as the Coupe version, and if I'm really honest, it probably doesn't handle quite as well as the GT350 or the GT500 that I last drove, but still has an absolutely excellent handling feel to it out on the road. And it's not just the handling ability, it's also the way the Camaro feels. And I've mentioned this in previous videos on the Camaro. The Camaro is very closely related to the Cadillac ATS Coupe, and remember that the ATS was designed as a direct competitor to the BMW 3 Series and the BMW 4 Series, and all of that has really gone right into the Camaro. This has a really great on-center steering feeling, it feels really, really predictable in the corners, and of course the level of grip is absolutely excellent. All versions of the Camaro feel really great in the corners, and of course the amount of grip that we find here is absolutely excellent. Couple that with the really raucous engine note. We go all the way down there to second gear, and this is an awful lot of fun. But I also have to say that the Camaro is surprisingly civilized, as I said before, because aside from those takeoffs, if you have the exhaust in its track mode, if you have this in the auto mode or the pretty typical touring mode, then it has a really nice exhaust note. It's loud when you want it to be loud, but it's not so loud that it's annoying the neighbors all the time. And even though this is the convertible, we don't have that same sort of in-cabin drone that we can see in the Hellcats, and we get a lot less supercharger whine. Now, on the downside, if you like hearing your supercharger, that may be a downside to the Camaro, but personally, I like a little bit of supercharger, but not a lot. When it comes to the overall ride, again, the Camaro is definitely very civilized compared to the likes of the Mustang GT350 that we tested not that long ago, or even something like the Hellcat, I'd give this ride an A-. It's not quite as supple as the Hellcat can be at sometimes, but it's also not as harsh as the more sporting alternatives. And remember, this definitely is more nimble than the Hellcat. The Hellcat doesn't do too badly all the way around, but it's almost 1,000 pounds heavier than this. When it comes to overall cabin noise, remember that we are in the convertible, and even in the quietest exhaust mode with the lid on, this clocked 74 decibels. So I'm gonna go ahead and give this a C when it comes to cabin noise. You definitely will have a slightly quieter experience in some of the competition. Fuel economy is a little bit difficult to talk about in a performance vehicle like this because it's really gonna depend on how you drive it. And if you're having the maximum amount of fun in your Camaro, then obviously your fuel economy is gonna be pretty terrible. When we first got our hands on this, the first 20, 30 miles or so, we were averaging about 10 mpg. But then I drove it to Napa for a weekend, and it was a pretty comfortable car on that longer journey, and we averaged about 22.5 miles per gallon. So again, it really will depend on your overall driving personality. The road trip to Napa, I think, really highlighted the dual personality of the Camaro ZL1, a personality that, again, I hadn't quite expected when I signed on the dotted line for this car, because I had expected this version to be just about as hardcore as the coupe. But this is an awful lot more livable. My back didn't really have any problems with a 2-hour drive, and the overall suspension tune is still pretty good even out on rougher roads like the one that we're on here, gravel roads, freeway expansion joints, that sort of thing. You'd have no problem going for a longer highway journey in this vehicle. There are a few things about the Camaro that I wish I could improve. Again, the sill height is a bit tall, so if I wanted to put my elbow right up there on the window as I'm driving topless, that's not something that's as easy to do in this as it is in some of the competition. And if I were to lift this seat all the way up to the point where I could put my elbow up there, then my head would be sticking pretty much in the air right there. And I'm not the shortest person out there. Again, I'm about 6 feet tall. So if you're a taller person, maybe that would work. But if you're a shorter person, the sills are definitely on the high side. I also wish we had a variety of different individual drive modes where you could adjust certain settings, save those to various presets, so that way you could have the steering the way you want it, the suspension the way you want it, the exhaust the way you want it, etc. Now those are adjustable in the infotainment system, but you can't save them to multiple different drive modes. But aside from that, I have very little to wish for in this vehicle. Again, the 10-speed automatic transmission is really a great asset to the Camaro, and the exhaust note is absolutely excellent. If you want to get your hands on a ZL1 convertible, be prepared to shell out at least $67,500. The model as we've been driving it today came in right around $72,000. This has almost all the options that are available on the convertible. Depending on how you want to look at it, the ZL1 is either a decent deal compared to the luxury entries that you might want to compare this to, because that's really the only way you're going to get a convertible with this kind of performance, or an awful lot to pay as far as a bump over the Camaro SS is concerned, because a Camaro SS convertible that will go 0 to 60 only about a half second slower than this will cost you $43,000. Now, of course, it's not just about the 0 to 60 time. This also handles better than the Camaro SS. It has that absolutely insane exhaust note, and then passing maneuvers are definitely going to be quicker in this than the Camaro because we get so much more power out of the engine. So 30 to 100, those scores definitely going to be better in this than the Camaro SS. 0 to 30 especially is really about managing traction when we're talking about a two-wheel drive vehicle and 400 or more horsepower. And traction control is definitely very, very well done in this, but we're still at the mercy of those two wheels in the rear. But $43,000 will get you the Camaro SS convertible with the 6-speed manual transmission basically the same setup that we have in the base version of the ZL1. You can also get the 10-speed automatic transmission in that Camaro SS, just like you can in the ZL1. Aside from that, there really is no direct competition for this, because something like a BMW M4 is actually going to be slower, and it's going to start more than a fully loaded ZL1 at 77,650. And that's going to get you 0 to 60 in around 4.1 to 4.2 seconds. If you want to go under 4 seconds in your drop top, you could look at something like a Mercedes-Benz C63S, but that's going to cost you at least $83,000. And that's not going to get you as quick 0 to 60 as the ZL1 still, only 503 horsepower in that particular model. But the biggest reason that this is not really an M4 or a 63S convertible is that this is a mainstream performance vehicle, so it's just not playing in the same pool as the luxury entries. Obviously, the interior is nowhere near as luxurious as the BMW or the Mercedes, but because of the origin of the Camaro, dating back again to the Cadillac ATS, the overall driving dynamics are shockingly similar to that BMW M4. When Cadillac created the ATS in its last generation, a lot of folks really said, my goodness, they've resurrected the previous generation BMW 3 Series. And a lot of that handling ability and handling nuance has translated right down here to the Camaro. Of course, this does have a slightly more classic American feel with the bigger, heavier engine up front than we'd find in a BMW M4. But the overall handling ability and especially the handling feel is still definitely there inside the Camaro. And that's a really big difference between this and something like the Hellcat. The Hellcat feels big, it feels heavy, it has that bigger, more grown-up feel to it. And in many ways, it is that classic American muscle car, and the Camaro and the Mustang really aren't. They're American interpretations of compact, luxury European sports cars. Now, the big thing to remember about this versus something like the Hellcat is that we don't really have a usable back seat in this or in the Mustang convertible. So definitely keep that in mind, that the back seat in this is best reserved for your briefcase, your purse, something along those lines. I wouldn't really want to put adults back there for any length of time. Now, if you're a family of shorter people, this might work out okay, but for the average American family, this is just going to be a little bit too tight. Be sure and let me know what you think about all that down there in the comments section below. And as always, let me know what you would choose in this segment if you were looking to spend around $70,000. Would you get something like this, or would you just stop where the Camaro SS convertible ends? I like the Camaro SS convertible just about as much as the ZL1. And I have to say that in my mind, I'm not entirely sure whether the delta between the SS and the ZL1 would really be worth it for me. But let me know what you think about that down there in the comments section below. Without question, however, the ZL1 really has no equal in America at the moment. I'll see you next week.